Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the third session of the TALC 2020 webinar series. Today, our speaker for the webinar is Dr. Varsha Gattu. She is a professional working in the field of special and inclusive education for over three decades. She has received the Vocational Excellence Award and also a National Award for Innovative Practices of NCERT to her credit. She has a PhD in Special Education and Disability Management. For the last 22 years, she has been heading the Department of Education at the National Institute for Speech and Hearing Disabilities in Mumbai. We are lucky to have you here with us, ma'am, and we all are looking forward to the webinar. I now invite you to start the session. Thank you.
Hello. And at the outset, I would like to thank the two organizations, TIS and Mumbai University Department of Education, as well as my institution, Ali Awadh National Institute for Speech and Hearing Disabilities, for providing me this opportunity to present my views before the August gathering, as well as the educators and teachers about what I think about diversity and the diverse needs of learners. Now, can we go on to the slide which talks about what is my session plan today? Being in the field of special ed and inclusive education, I have a perspective of my own towards how we look at individuals, and so I would talk about the construct of diversity in general and the human diversity of disability. That is what I feel is missed out many a times. We need to know about the international classification of the disability as a diversity, human diversity. At the same time, we should know our national act, that is the Rights of Persons with Disability Act, 2016. And it has increased the number of disabilities. We all being in the 21st century, and many of you who are going to be teachers of the 21st century are preparing teachers for the 21st century. I feel that we need to address the diverse learners of 21st century. And then I would have some takeaway messages for you. So the objectives are in front of you, matching to the session. I would go on to the next slide of storytelling. Yes, dear participants, I have started my career as a educator, and I'm a teacher at the core of my heart. And you know, teachers like to tell stories and children like to listen to stories. So if somebody asks me, what do you want to do later in life? I want to be a storyteller. So I would start my presentation and my thoughts with a story, and I would also have a concluding story. You could see the Jungle Book there out. Take a minute and see the questions of the different animals. Probably they want to ask, or answer the head teacher who's asking them, why aren't you or your children attending schools? Why do they want to drop out? You know, some of them want to really tell the head teacher, please sir, have a look at your table. There's a fish pot on your table, and we envy the fish. Why? Because you are calling the fish a genius amongst us. And why is that so? Because you're not allowing us to, you know, showcase our abilities or learn the way we want or live the way we want, because learning is to living. And you live to learn, isn't it? So the fish is allowed, but why aren't we? Oh my God, the head teacher got the answer that the students are dropping out not because the curriculum, but even the learning experiences, the living experiences in the school. It's such a big lesson for us, friends, when we talk of the school climate, the school culture, which leads to the school ethos. Probably the headmaster, the head teacher, realized that why was the fish genius in her school, in his school? That was because the fish was judged by the ability that it was good at. And look at the monkey, you know, on the tree, telling the fish that if you were asked to climb like me on the tree, probably the whole life you would have thought, you would have believed, and you would have probably misjudged yourself being a stupid. And look how the peers understand each other. They know what each of them is good at. So much, friends, to learn from the nature and the environment today. And that is why I feel that all the stalwarts who wrote about education, whether it was Mahatma Gandhi or whether it was in Shantiniketan, Tagore said, you know, give free education, and they actually propagated education in the natural environment. And today is the time, friends, we go back to our roots and say that education has to be in the natural environment. Education has to be using the daily routines. Think of us, who were our teachers? Yes, none other than our parents. And I feel among the parents also, it was the mother who was our first and the most important teacher. And how did the mother teach us? She did not have a blackboard. She did not have a curriculum. But definitely, the mother had the instinct to teach her child. And she used the daily routine, which is the natural environment. She taught us the verbs. She taught us the nouns. She taught us the numbers, the colors, the concept of heavy and light, near and far. Everything while she was in the kitchen or in the home environment, and we as babies were around her. So coming back to our diverse learners, the diverse learners are also same, but we consider diversity as something very different. We have lots of myths about diversity. When it comes to diversity, we feel that majority of the people have something in common. So diversity is about the non-majority. That is the marginalized or the minority people. We don't feel that we are diverse. Diversity is about them, it's not about us, and we feel it's about people who are different. But friends, take a minute after this session, or take 10 minutes, list down from A to Z, what are the different diversities that you see amongst yourself and your colleagues, your family members, or your friends around you. I'm sure from attitude, A for attitude, B for behavior, C for culture, communication modes, D is the, you know, you can talk about the way you dialogue. It's everything, the food, the clothes, the music, everything, our likings are diverse. So diversity is one true thing that all of us have common. Another myth about diversity is, and this is especially for teachers, they feel diversity brings in stagnation. Meaning, if you cater to the diverse needs of the learners in the class, meaning some child learns this way, the other child needs this, or one child can't hear well, one child can't speak well, somebody requires more visual, they feel how will they complete their portion? You know, it will bring in stagnation is what they feel. But no, the diversity is there for sustainability. The United Nations Millennium Declaration of 2000 about diversity says that the cultural, human, and biodiversity brings in sustainability. And they urge the nation that unless there is diversity and unless you preserve the diversity, the world is not going to sustain. Take, for example, the rice plant. We all know that the rice needs a lot of water to thrive. But there is a variety of rice on this earth in our own country called sal, which actually thrives in drought situation. So see, the maker of this universe has also taken care of diversity. And I really like that ad. I don't know which mobile it was, but her friend zaruri hota hai. You know, some friends are good at this, the other friends are good at that. And I really like that ad, ki har friend life mein zaruri hota hai. Sometimes we feel diversity is a win or a lose proposition. You know, if you are catering to majority of the people, the teachers feel, oh, my class has done so well. But take a moment, look at your body structure, friends. You can see the two ends of your shoulder, flat ends. And there is a bell curve. The God has made a bell curve in our body itself. So there are certain students whom we call the gifted children. There are certain students who probably need something else in the class for them to succeed. So it is not the, the left versus right. But if what we do in today's time is just take the golden average and we teach the average students of the class because we want 90% result in our class. But you remember the movie Tare Zameen Pe? It was the innovation, the creativity which really brought about the success. So diversity is a great driver of innovation, I feel. I remember one of my class students, Balkrishna, he had difficulty in dividing. You know, he actually taught me innovations in mathematics. So for him to divide 24 by 5, I had done so much of experimentation with him and ultimately I succeeded. And I feel that I became an innovator in that institution only because of this child who had a diverse thinking. Diversity, the fourth myth is diversity is just about race and gender. We only talk of gender diversity. But as I said, we have got so many of that. Even within children, you would have children with disabilities, without disabilities, children of migrant workers, children of, you know, war affected people. So many children are there and we as a teaching fraternity have to cater to the needs of all children. The next slide. When we talk of diversity, automatically, we think about our sensory organs. We feel, you know, some people cannot see, some cannot hear, some do not think as we think, or some cannot move. But even I feel those who are so-called able-bodied people, do you think the sense organ, which actually helps us to socialize, move, or read, do we see things like the way others think? You definitely would have taken a course in psychology and you know the inkblot test of Rauschenberg, in which in the same experiment, everybody sees it differently. So a small baby who starts seeing and socializing with the first smile that it gives to its mother. When you move the toys in front of him, he starts moving slowly and steadily, starts, you know, reading, recognizing, the sense organ of hearing, we never, you know, really pay attention, because, you know, we feel that hearing is 24/7. It comes so naturally to us. But this organ is so important for us to understand each other. If I say, Ningalude class illa ethra kutikalu unde, some of you who are probably from Kerala would have understood it. But others from the other parts of the country would probably say, what are you talking of, ma'am? So you would have heard it, but you would not have understood it. I'll repeat it. Ningalude class illa ethra kutikalu unde. So, you know, it's not just hearing, but understanding what others are saying. If you understand what others are saying, you will start speaking. And if you understand and if you speak, you start communicating. It's same with thinking and movement. So all these organs are sense organs. They have to be in place, and even if they are in place, you know, they are all functioning differently. So if we function differently, why do we call somebody able and disabled? I think even if we have all the sense organs, we are disabled for certain things. And look at it. What does the international classification of WHO talks about disability? Yes, you know, we loosely use these terms, impairment, disability, and handicap. Why blame others? My own institution had earlier name as handicap, and somebody, a commissioner of disability, who was himself a person with a visual impairment, he challenged the court and he said, handicap is demeaning to us. Why? Because it literally means a hand in the cap. So we need to understand these words probably. Impairment is any loss of organ, for example, eyes or the hearing. So it's affecting our body. And due to this loss of an organ and not able to hear, we are not able to do the daily activities which I showed you in the last slide. We are not able to move, or we are not able to see, we are not able to communicate. And those are the routine essential activities that we are doing, like brushing, bathing, you know, getting ready, going off to office or school. That's the disabling conditions. But this disabling condition is not within the purview of this individual. It's the restricted movement which the society has not taken care of. So it's the social angle to the impairment that the person has resulted in. And because the person is not able to participate or have an engaged life, he or she becomes dependent on others, not able to do the job properly, and that creates a handicapping condition. So impairment by itself is not a handicap. Impairment, when it is not taken care of by the society, by the school, or by the family, it creates a disabling condition, and which it's the secondary prevention. If that is not taken care of, then it leads to the third, that is the tertiary condition of handicapping. So when we talk of ICF, we also need to know that in our own country, we have the Rights of Persons with Disability Act. We earlier had in 1995 the Persons with Disability Act, which had recognized the needs of seven disabilities. But in the RPWD now, we have 21 disabilities which are recognized. And it's not just recognizing in terms of, you know, reservations or facilities, but they are more concerned. The underlying feature of that is learning. Learning and the functioning of these people should not be affected. And I'm glad that in this particular act, and also in the RTE and other things, people have talked about capacity building of teachers so that the teachers understand this as a human diversity and creates and it, you know, propagates about inclusive education. So coming to the 21 disabilities, these are categorized into 5 sections under the RPWD Act, and I have given you a link of it. In locomotor, you have the leprosy cured, cerebral palsy, dwarfism, which is a new addition, muscular dysatrophy, and acid attack victims. The visual impairment, which was already there, blindness and low vision. We have the hearing impaired. We've had it earlier, but we have addition of the hard of hearing. And in the D section, we have the speech and language disabilities, meaning the children who have speech problems of stuttering, stammering, or aphasia. Under the second category, I've put on the movie names there for you to identify with it. We have the intellectual disabilities, in which we have the addition of the specific learning disabilities and the autism spectrum disorders. The next, the third category is about the mental illness, and you see a lot of it being talked these days. Actually, we have a National Institute of Mental Health coming up in Sihor in Madhya Pradesh, and our Prime Minister, Secretary, and our Minister are all talking these days about the mental health and well-being of people, especially in the COVID situation. And this institution will bring about all these things. So mental illness is a separate category which is put up as a benchmark disability in the RPWD Act. We have recognized certain medical conditions which disable the people, which has multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, hemiplegia, thalassemia, sickle cell disease. Now, you would say, what has that to do with learning, friends? See, it is like this, that children who have got the blood disorders, they are going to miss out on schools. So how do we compensate for the attendance of these children? Can we do something as home training for these kids? And in today's time, when we are all, you know, locked down home, we know how to use the alternative modes of communication and also having the teaching learning sessions. So something to cater to the medical conditions is also available in the RPWD Act. We have the multiple disabilities, in the sense, I really like what the Act has said, that you don't have to wait for another parliamentary act to come up for any other disability. But in case if you come across, meaning if the government comes across, they could go on adding about, you know, the difficult conditions that children and youth face for education in particular or functioning in particular. So friends, it's necessary for us to know what is the RPWD Act, because we are moving and we have already moved into the era of inclusive education and inclusive practices. So now that we know that there is so much diversity around us, and disability is also a human diversity, and we should not have be so skeptical about it, that it's not our baby, it's not our child, that special child belongs to the special school. No, it's the inclusive school which probably will help the child in the longer run of sustainability. So when it comes to diversity, we know that there is physical and biological diversity. We'll have children with dwarfism also in our class. We will have children also with medical conditions in our class and maybe impairments. We have socio-cultural diversity. Children bring in different cultures in the class. They belong to different socio-economic strata. And that's what the RTE says, 24% reservation for different children coming from marginalized section. We have cognitively different children in the class. And by cognitive difference, I just don't mean mental retardation or mental behavior or anything. You know, the cognitive abilities are so different the way we memorize things, some of us may have a good auditory memory, some may have a good visual memory, some may be good at good problem solving skills, some may be good at spatial relations. So the cognitive abilities are different, and that slogan, har friend zaruri hota hai. So you never know which friend you require when. Our outlook towards life is so different. You would see in your class somebody being so positive about coronavirus that you are at home, you know, you don't have to get ready for school or college. Or somebody would say, oh, I'm glad that my hubby has started cooking. And somebody would say, oh my gosh, I can't go out. I can't go to movies. I can't go to my favorite restaurant. So the outlook is different. We are diverse. Who other than Gardner talked so much about multiple intelligences and dispositions? We see the full orchestra in our class. Somebody a good composer, somebody a good tabla vadak, somebody a good musician, somebody who is good at, you know, comparing the orchestra. The urge is different in different children in the class, and that makes the whole class a complete whole holistic in its own this thing. Some children have got a disposition towards plants and urge to take care of the garden in the school. Some children are really good at intrapersonal relationship. They are so good to their teachers. They are so good to their fellow class students. So we have multiple intelligences, we have dispositions in the class, and that gives rise to different skills and abilities. And imagine a world full of all teachers. My goodness, they would have gone crazy. Imagine a world full of architects. My God, who would have treated people? Imagine a whole world only of doctors. No, we don't want to just eat medicines, right? We need people with different skills. We need people with different abilities, because the life is so different. Each day is different and each hour is different. We don't want the same boring life. We want variety in our life. And for variety, we require people with different skills. We want people with different abilities. How many of us are missing the TV shows these days? Because, you know, we all love to watch different people saying differently, the different food shows, the different travel blogs, and the different serials. So friends, without diversity, the world would have been just one simple color. We all love rainbow, isn't it? So diversity is for living, and we need to accept the diversity. And friends, I have given you a link of a TED talk by Marshika, and it has opened my eyes, you know. I had a student with me for MED, her name is Jigya. She worked a lot about teaching styles and learning styles, and she tried to match and see whether the learning styles of children match the teaching styles of teachers, and whether that makes a difference in the classroom. And then later on, Jigya decided to take it up as her thesis topic for PhD. And both I and Jigya learned the good and the bad thing about learning style. The bad thing is that there exists no learning styles, it seems. And there have been so many agencies promoting just the learning style inventories. And if you see the TED talk, and I'm a great fan of Marshika, she says, the learning styles don't exist at all. She says it's the learning preferences. And when I also thought about it, because as you know, my friends or my family members also say, story sunna hai to Varsha se suno. So they feel I'm a good storyteller. But if I want to tell them the story of an entire movie, they would say, we would rather better go and see the movie version. So, you know, at times we change, our preferences change. If I'm sure if you want to listen to music, you would like to listen it auditorily rather than read the song on the screen, isn't it? So the preferences depend upon the situation. At times we could be visual if we want to just read a book by ourselves sitting in the swing. You may be an auditory if you are tired, your eyes are tired after the day's work. You just want to relax and probably even audio hear a book. And sometimes you are so bored and you say, oh, I don't want to see all these things. I want to do something by myself. It's not just cooking, but it could be the different, shapes that you make from the blocks or, the origami art. So it all depends upon the situation. You may prefer different modalities at different pace. So the lesson to be learned from here is, don't categorize the learners of your class into auditory, visual, or kinesthetic. If that was true, then there's an experiment of Chase and Simon in 1973, where they proved that if you show the chessboard and the movements to two groups of people, first group who are a novice to chess, and the second group who are actually experienced chess players. If we believe the theory of learning styles, then the visual learners by chutki would have learned all these things. But no, what they found out at the time of the experiment is, it was the experience which made a difference. So the experienced people in chess could tell what are the moves and what was right and what was wrong. If it was just the visual learner without any experience of chess, then probably they would not, and they did not fare well on it. And that's why, when it comes to teaching or learning experiences, I feel that it's, you may be good at auditorily remembering things. That auditory memory versus visual memory versus kinesthetic memory is different than the modalities. So don't confuse between the modalities and your preferences. So friends, see the preferences, and what I feel in learning, three things are important. The memory, of course, but the second thing is your own interest in it. And the third, the experience. If you relate your teaching to your learner's experience or to the interest of the learner, I think each and every child will learn in your class. And we are here to promote learning. So why not take the learning preferences, the learning experiences, and connect it to the real life situation, the experiences of the child. And I feel each and every child will be motivated. And that will make the dream realize of UNESCO, which says every learner matters and matters equally. I'll repeat. Every learner matters and matters equally. We as teachers will feel satisfied that we have catered to all the children. We have differences in which we process the information. And this is what, there are about 78 models of cognitive styles. There's Kolb's model, which is very, very famous. There is Honey and Mumford's model. I just wanted to give you some glimpse of it, that all these models have something in common. So it's not just your child's learning style and teaching style, but the way the child processes the information, the genetic makeup of each child is different, friends. A person who is a divergent learner, he's a mix. He wants concrete experience as well as he wants to reflect on his own. If he's an assimilator, he wants to reflect, plus he wants to make a theory of his own. If the learner is a converger, he wants active experimentation as well as theory testing. And if he's an accommodator in today's world, which is what Honey Mumford says, a pragmatist, he is the one who puts the theory or everything into practice. So, go through the cognitive styles. There are about 78 classifications of it, as I said, but each one of that has an overlapping function And we can come out with, you know, different categories of learners who are in today's classroom. You can see each and every example of it. Moving on to the 21st century's era, I feel, and we have missed out a classification of diversity, which is not just based on the race, the culture, the gender, the language, etc., or the geographical diversity, but it's the multi-generational diversity. We have 5 generations right now in the field of education. The traditionalist, that is my own teachers who have taught me, Dr. Ratna, Dr. Swaroop, Dr. Ghate, these are all my teachers who are still contributing in the field of education. We have the boomers born between 1946 to 64, the era which I am in. We have the generation X between 65 to 76. We have the generation Y, that is 77 to 97. And the generation Z, which are in the classrooms. Generational diversity, which we never really thought of it probably. The traditionalists, they respect still the authority. They know we are the policy makers. They are very dedicated, but they are conservative. Boomers, that is, are this thing, we like team working because we lived in big families. We are idealistic. We want everything perfect. The Xers, they work to live. They are very, very adaptive and they are pragmatic. My children are of this age. So I feel they are very pragmatic, but they are very result-oriented. Most of the teachers probably are the Xers today and the teacher educators, the boomers. The next, the Yers. For them, the whole idea is control or delete. They are the digital learners. They earn for immediate consumption. And they always ask the question, why? Why does this happen? Why is this so? They are socially active, very, very confident. And that's the group which we have to today prepare as the torch bearers of tomorrow's teachers for the Zers. And Zers, my God, they are born in the digital world. And we probably are trying to teach them. They are the ones. You give them the mobiles in 2 minutes, they will understand everything. They are your teachers for the digital world today. They are born in the digital world. They have never seen a world without internet. You see the babies today, they are all doing this because they know only the finger moves. That's the smartphone. They are all screen lovers. Their parents put their screens when they want them to be engaged. So they perceive information visually, and you would love the cartoon on the net. Look at it. That's my niece. With her mom's permission, I have the photograph there. And, you know, the child there says, how do you think was my day in kindergarten, mom? They did not even have the Wi-Fi. Look at it. The digital generation next. The children today are digital learners. So friends, we have made a paradigm shift from in the teaching arena, from homogeneity to heterogeneity, and now we are into diversity. In homogeneity, you would have remembered the classrooms, A section, B section, or the morning shift, afternoon shift, according to the marks or the abilities of the children. Differences were not acknowledged. Heterogeneity, the learners were perceived to be different, but then adjustments were made to come to terms with their different needs. The difference was seen as a challenge to be dealt with. And so we still had the sections in the class, or what we used to call grouping for instructions. We had the station teacher model that time. But now in the 21st century, we into the inclusive classrooms, we are into recognizing diversity as a resource. And we believe that everybody has resource. The diversity is seen as an asset, and we are now converting the diverse, that is the resources, into assets and not about any load on the teaching. So every child learns differently. Every child has got different things to contribute. So when you make the group, somebody is good at model making, somebody is good at script writing, somebody is good at explaining things. So we are seeing diversity as a human resource, and that is going to take us ahead. So diversity and inclusion go hand in hand. And in simple terms, I feel the way these colors are mixed, such beautiful they look at. We can't really segregate one color from another. They have mixed up so well. In simple terms, diversity is the mix, and inclusion is getting the mix to work well together. And that's the crux. So we have to have diversity at the workplace also, so that we have a good team, which is, you know, even in the cricket, you know, they have a mix of good bowlers, good batsmen, and good wicket keeping. Only then the team succeeds. Otherwise, if the team is only good in bowling or the team is only good in batting, it's going to fall like the cycle stand. You know the cycle stand, isn't it? If one cycle falls, all others fall. No, we want diversity in class. We need diversity at the workplace. And I would love to have a course on diversity before we start any university program. I would like to quickly give you a solution that if we have the diverse learners in our classrooms, what is the way forward to it? You would say, ma'am, it's not possible. 40, 50 children in the class, each one diverse, and we teaching them as per their preferences, as per their modalities, or as per the way they are most comfortable with, or they like about it, or their experiences. Today's world is, as I said, moving towards, you know, we have to have flipped classrooms. Gone are the days when we had the sage on the stage, that is the teacher on the dais and delivering the lecture. We want a guide by the couch. We want to be a teacher by the student. We want to be a guide by the couch. And that's the flipped classroom that I'm talking of. We should have station teacher model. And the solution to diversity, the D is in the middle of the UDL. It's the universal design of learning. It started with our field of architecture, where they use universal design. We use universal design of learning. In a minute, I will tell you the difference. In architecture, they say one solution for all. Meaning, if you step at the airport door, it opens because it has sensors. That's a universal design of architecture, where one design works for everybody. But in the learning and in the arena of education, we use the L to it. Universal design of learning, where we say have a buffet approach, cafeteria approach. You know, the teacher provides multiple means of expression, multiple means of representation. It has three principles, the UDL has. Multiple means of representation, meaning you can have a station teacher model. For example, if you want to teach about the circulatory mechanism, you have different stations in your classroom. You have somewhere where there are puzzles and children learn about circulatory system. You have another corner where there are, you know, activity where children can actually do and learn about the circulatory mechanism. You can have a computer somewhere where the children can watch the video of circulatory mechanism. And you can have a script for circulatory mechanism where one child becomes the heart, the other child becomes the lungs, and you know there are arteries, veins. You can actually have the movement of circulatory mechanism on your floor also. You know, the red lines and the blue lines can be made by the tapes. The red tape and the blue tape, you get it in the market. You can show the pure blood and the impure blood also. So it's all about arranging your classrooms in different ways. That's multiple means of presentation. So provide alternatives, allow the children to choose their station teacher, their different stations, and allow them. The engagement is the third principle, but I would say it the second. If you provide them the different options, they will be engaged in the way they can learn. And as I said from that TED talk, their experiences, their interest, and their motivation are different. So they will engage in the activities. Give them choices. UDL is all about choices. Give them choices. Allow them to pick up their choices. And third, action and expression. It's allowing the children to express the way they have learned and the way they are able to express themselves. So provide them options of maybe writing on the computer, drawing it out, or making a model of it, or simply coming and talking in front of the class the way they have understood about the lesson of circulatory mechanism. So UDL in learning is different than UD of architecture. In learning, we say provide options for representation, for engagement, and for expression. So this is a story which, if you have read it, it's a Shiv Khera story from his book, You Can Win. It's a story of a balloon seller, and you can read the story for yourself on the screen later on. But in a gist, it is that the balloon seller had different kinds of balloons. The children would come and, you know, pick up the choice of their balloon. When the sales went down, the balloon seller used to put balloons in the sky so that the children could get attracted and come. One day, a small child came and tugged at the balloon seller's jacket and asked, "If you release the black balloon, would that also fly?" The balloon seller, for a moment, thought of it. Oh my God, this boy feels that the color, outside color, makes a difference. Will the black balloon fly high? And the balloon seller says, "Son, it's not the outside color, it's inside what is there, which makes the balloon go up, up, up." So the gas is same in all the balloons. So similarly, friends, the inside is same for each child. The urge, the quest, the urge to excel, the disposition to be at the top, whether it's the family, whether it's the school, whether it's the society. The inner instincts of children are the same. Outwardly, they may look diverse. Outwardly, they may look different. But each one of them has got the same inner urge and the disposition to learn. We teachers have to only give them a minute to understand them. How do they learn? What are their interests? What are their experiences? If we connect that to that, they will all be able to excel. Remember in the story of tortoise and the rabbit, the rabbit need not sleep always. Put on the roller skaters to the tortoise and the tortoise will go zoom. So you don't have to, children don't have to depend upon somebody's weakness. You can empower them by knowing their needs, and that is how it will help each and every child to excel. Thank you. That's where I feel that we need to. The driver is also saying, someone quit the back door, stop, shut the door, back door. We don't want any more school dropouts from the schools. If we understand the learning needs, if we understand each learner, the success is ahead. Thank you very much. Yeah,
thank you very much, Varsha. This is Maithili. There are three questions already in the Q&A box. I will read them out to you. So the first question is, do people with autoimmune disease come under fourth category of disability? of disability?
I would have to cross-check it before I commit to anything. But, you know, the disabilities which are caused due to medical conditions are generally under the fourth category of disabilities. If you are talking of multiple sclerosis, the Parkinson's disease, it is to elder people. But hemophilia, thalassemia, or sickle cell anemia are the kids who are born with it, and they have problems in attending school. So there are a lot of provisions for these children which are being made by different state governments under the people under the policy of inclusive practices.
The second question is ADHD a disability since it affects learning badly?
Yes. They have not categorized ADHD as a disability. It's the ASD, the autism spectrum disorder. But, you know, children with ADHD are also included, you know, that is what the Act has said. It has kept it open for any of the additions. And if a particular state or the government feels that, see, it's all about accommodation. It is all about adaptations. They are not saying, you know, any child to be left out. So if a school or a teacher or the educational institution feels that this particular child needs some adaptations, needs some accommodation in his classrooms, it's all the more imperative that those are the things. So it's the removing the barrier. So it is the creating a barrier-free environment so that all children can learn in the classrooms.
I think the next question is also related to your response now. We face a lot of problems related to multiple disabilities as a teacher. How can we manage it's difficult in inclusive class?
Yeah, so instead of focusing on the disability part of it, if we focus on the learning needs of the child. See, children with the same disability will also have different learning needs. As I said, focus on the cognitive ability, the cognitive styles of the children. Same two or three deaf children who have got the same audiogram, they have got different perceptual abilities. Their speech perception would differ. Their visual perception would differ. They would, you know, in an experiment we found out that actually the deaf children prefer the auditory mode of teaching in the classrooms. So we should not go by disability. We should go by the learning needs of the child. Within the disability also, their learning needs are different. So focus on the learning needs. And then you would get an answer about the multiple disabilities.
How to help students with dysgraphia and processing deficits?
Okay, now these are the specific questions for this thing to answer about the specific learning disabilities. There, I wouldn't say that there is one quick solution given for children who have got dysgraphia or dyscalculia or dyslexia, that is the reading difficulty, the writing difficulty, or the mathematical difficulty. There are short courses which are going to be offered. There are already being offered by SNDT and the other institutions who deal with the specific learning disabilities. But the Rehabilitation Council of India, the RCI, is coming up with small courses on different disabilities. And I think that is now in the process. And if we have these short certification programs, it would help the teachers to know about it. Again, not giving a quick solution to the dysgraphia, because this session basically was to, you know, give a glimpse of different learners in the classroom. But there are specific strategies, and to answer to your specific strategies, I could give you the links where you could pick up the strategies for, you know, the dyslexia or dysgraphia. Because these are again spectrum, these are range of it. It would be right from spelling errors to the auditory processing problems, because it's the auditory processing which helps you to write it down.
Very much, Varsha. This was indeed a very insightful session and very informative as well. Managed to pack quite a bit in the 50 minutes that was actually 45 minutes that was assigned to you. Thank you very much.